Welcome to worship at Calvin Presbyterian Church. We're glad you're joining us today. My thanks to those who are leading in worship today, to Mark Bilyeu, our Director of Music, to Kylie Hazelton and Miles Herr, to Dave Shaughnessy, and to Joel Wenz, our videographer. This is the day that the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. Let us worship God.
God calls us to worship this day. Christ calls us to be the church, to love God and one another. We gather as sisters and brothers in Christ, praising God's faithfulness. We gather embracing each other in God's love, committed to acting out that love in God's world. We worship God in joy, in expectation, and in hope. We are not alone. Thanks be to God. Let us pray. Loving God, we come this day to worship with so many things on our hearts and minds. In this time of worship, draw us away from our problems and cares. Heal our spirits, open our hearts, help us live as Christ's disciples. In his name we pray. Amen.
First dew fall on the first grass.
The 21st Psalm was a prayer used for worship services and also for teaching about the faith. The psalmist is pleading for God to accept repentance for some unknown action and to show the way to live faithfully. As we prepare to hear God's word, let us pray. Gracious God, bless our struggle to hear your word. Bless our doubts, our wrongdoings about life's deep questions and deeper mysteries. Teach us to love our questions as well as your answers. Amen. To you, O Lord, I lift up my soul. O my God, in you I trust. Do not let me be put to shame. Do not let my enemies exult over me. Do not let those who wait for you to be put to shame. Let them be ashamed who are wantonly treacherous. Make me to know your ways, O Lord. Teach me your paths. Lead me in your truth and teach me, for you are the God of my salvation. For you I wait all day long. Be mindful of your mercy, O Lord, and of your steadfast love, for they have been from of old. Do not remember the sins of my youth or my transgressions. According to your steadfast love, remember me. For your goodness's sake, O Lord, good and upright is the Lord. Therefore, he instructs sinners in the way. He leads the humble in what is right and teaches the humble his way. All the paths of the Lord are steadfast love and faithfulness for those who keep his covenant and his decrees.
Your mercy, hear my prayer, your grace.
The second scripture reading for today is from the book of Philippians, chapter 2, verses 1 through 13. Philippi was one of the first places that Paul visited on his travels through Greece. You can tell he fondly remembered the believers there. He starts his letter saying, "I thank God every time I remember you." The followers of Jesus Christ in Philippi grew in numbers into a significant community. They were strong supporters of Paul as he continued on his ministry across Greece and on into other places. In this section of the letter, Paul tells the believers how to live as Christ lived. So listen to the word of God as it comes to us from Philippians chapter 2. If there is any encouragement in Christ, any consolation from love, any sharing in the Spirit, any compassion and sympathy, make my joy complete. Be of the same mind, having the same love, being in full accord and of one mind. Do nothing from selfish ambition or conceit, but in humility regard others as better than yourselves. Let each of you look not to your own interests, but to the interests of others. Let the same mind be in you that was in Christ Jesus, who, though he was in the form of God, did not regard equality with God as something to be exploited, but emptied himself, taking the form of a slave, being born in human likeness. And being found in human form, he humbled himself and became obedient to the point of death, even death on a cross. Therefore, God also highly exalted him and gave him the name that is above every name, so that at the name of Jesus every knee shall bow, in heaven and on earth and under the earth, and every tongue shall confess that Jesus is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. Therefore, my beloved, just as you have always obeyed me, not only in my presence, but much more now in my absence, work out your own salvation with fear and trembling. For it is God who is at work in you, enabling you both to will and to work for his good pleasure. Here ends the reading of God's holy word. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. This year I find myself turning to the writings of the Apostle Paul more than I usually would. I try to choose from the variety of texts the lectionary offers us each week, but in the end, I generally end up choosing the Gospels or the Old Testament passage. However, this year, the epistles seem to be speaking to me. I suspect it's because we are in the midst of what is proving to be a contentious year. We are divided over the handling of COVID-19. We are divided in our country over so much. This year, Paul's writings are speaking to me about how we get along with others with whom we disagree. Paul was no stranger to conflict between people. Quite apart from the usual differences of opinions that arise when a group of people try to work together, there were deep cultural disparities in the communities to whom Paul was writing. The churches that Paul started were filled with people who strictly followed the laws of Judaism, as well as people from other religious and cultural traditions with no interest in hearing about the Jewish laws about food and observing the Sabbath. And add in that the early believers did not yet have the advantage of reading the Gospels and would have had partial understanding of Jesus. Would have been a miracle if these churches had no conflict. If you study Paul's letters, many focus on conflicts between the followers of Christ. Paul's letters are filled with reprimands and cajoling and begging people to stop their quarreling. He seems to envision a community where everyone lives in harmony, leading to peace, the kind of lasting peace that we are not very good at, the kind of peace that God alone offers. This congregation in Philippi that Paul was writing to seems to have been one of the healthier communities that he had begun. He started and ended his letter to them speaking warm words of affection. Granted, there is a reference towards the end of the letter about two people who were clearly embroiled in a conflict, but overall, this group of believers in Philippi was not as conflicted as many of the other congregations who received Paul's letters. He appears to have genuine affection for these group of believers. One of the key words in this letter is actually joy. Now, I do not usually associate Paul with the word joy. I suspect for many that word joy also does not come to mind in relationship to Christianity. Even those of us who consider ourselves Christians seem to focus more on the challenges of faith than on the joy of having a relationship with Christ. We're in the church. We in the church can fixate on conflicts that, like Paul's church, will inevitably arise. Paul calls us to imitate Christ. Mahatma Gandhi, in the struggle to liberate India from British rule, reportedly said, "I like your Christ. I do not like your Christians. Your Christians are so unlike your Christ." Paul is encouraging us to adopt Christ-like attitudes. How do we live as imitators of Christ? How do we allow people to see Christ in us? And just how do we live in the midst of a conflicted world where people move to their corners so quickly and are inclined to stay there? On the morning that I was completing this sermon, I had listened to the short service of Ruth Bader Ginsburg just after her casket had been brought to lie in state at the Supreme Court building. I heard the rabbi intone an opening prayer and chant the 23rd Psalm in Hebrew and in English. Before the service had begun, the radio announcer told of meeting people who were standing outside the building waiting to honor Ruth Bader Ginsburg. The reporter told of speaking with people from Pennsylvania, from Ohio, from as far away as Colorado, who had come to honor and say goodbye to this woman whom Chief Justice John Roberts would call in that service a fighter for equal justice. What was it about this woman that she captured the attention and respect of so many in our country? I remember my mother telling me when she was young, a woman could not even get a credit card on her own. A woman had to have a husband or a father co-sign on the card. I can still picture my mother's credit card from Dayton's when I was a child that had her name, Mrs. Warren Reed, imprinted on it. Ruth Bader Ginsburg fought for women to be treated as equals in this country. She fought for pay equity. She fought not only for women. One of her landmark cases was on behalf of a widower fighting to receive Social Security benefits, something that had previously been reserved for widows. RBG fought for equal rights for all. As a professional woman who started out in a traditionally male-dominated field where there were those in the Presbyterian Church who let me know they thought ordained clergy should be men alone, I knew that I was standing on the shoulders of women like RBG who fought so I might have a voice. After the memorial service on Wednesday morning, I got back to work on the sermon. It was then that I started thinking about the friendship that many of us have heard that existed between Ruth Bader Ginsburg and another Supreme Court judge, Antonin Scalia. They were polar opposites in so many ways, and they argued adamantly against one another's opinions in court again and again. You would have thought they would have had nothing civil to say to one another outside the courtroom. Yet these two had reportedly been friends since the 1980s. Look online and you can find photos of them together with their spouses celebrating New Year's Eve or riding atop an elephant on a trip to India. They shared a love of opera, which they attended together. I love a quote from RBG, who said of her friend, "As annoyed as you might be about his zinging dissent, he's so utterly charming, so amusing, so sometimes outrageous, you can't help but say, I'm glad he's my friend and he's my colleague." Sometimes she said she had to pinch herself not to laugh in the courtroom where the other judge would say things that were so audacious. Despite all their differences, which were deep and were their core beliefs, they remained close friends until Antonin Scalia's death last year. The two of them modeled something we don't often see. This petite, soft-spoken, liberal Jewish judge and this large, gregarious, conservative Roman Catholic judge. They modeled a willingness to move beyond their differences to find what they shared as much as what they disagreed about. Paul encourages us to live with openness to one another. Christ shows us the face of God that is love. Christ showed us not to be afraid to speak truth to power, but to speak it with grace, with love, with humility. Christ showed us how to respond and respect others whose beliefs were different than our own, but to do so always with love. This is an ongoing process, living so that Christ is reflected in us, in our words and in our actions. Sometimes we get it wrong. Sometimes our ego speaks before our mind really engages. Yet thanks be to God, still God is at work within us. Thanks be to God, we can try another time. Thanks be to God who is with us in our struggles to live lives modeling ourselves after Jesus the Christ. Amen.
On a journey, we're together.
In our prayers of the people today, I will be offering some prayers, and when I say, God, in your grace, you are invited to respond. Hear our prayer. God, in your grace, hear our prayer. Let us pray. Blessing and honor and glory be to you, O God. God of all time and space, of all wisdom and knowledge, we worship and adore you. We come as your people, offering the light that we have seen in Jesus the Christ. Your Spirit leads us to walk in your ways. Loving God, hold us close when we fear and do not understand the way before us. Open us to the ones who await your welcome through us. May our own frailty make us more gracious, and may we rejoice that in caring for others, we welcome and serve you. God, in your grace, hear our prayer. Hear the prayer we lift for someone who has been important in our lives, and bless them, we pray. God, in your grace, hear our prayer. God of grace, hear our prayer for someone who has helped us when we really needed it, someone who may not even know that they helped us. And oh God, may your peace be with them. God, in your grace, hear our prayer. Loving God, hear us as we pray for someone who has reached out to us when we felt uncertain or even had lost hope. Bless the one who has reached out to us. Help us to do the same in our own lives. God, in your grace, hear our prayer. Healing God, we lift before you someone we hold in our hearts who is ill or hurting. Hear our prayers for healing. Hear our prayers for those who are caring for another. And God, give them all strength and courage. God, in your grace, hear our prayer. God of compassion, we lift before you someone who is unhappy, who has lost a loved one or lost their way, or just doesn't know what to do or how to face the future. Oh God, help them move forward in hope. God, in your grace, hear our prayer. God of grace, hear the prayers we lift for so many in our country who have lost so much due to wildfires or due to hurricanes. Be with all who are uncertain about how to face tomorrow, and show us how we might help. God, in your grace, hear our prayer. All these things we ask in the name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, who taught us to pray together, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Go into the world blessed with the wisdom and understanding of God, filled with the gentleness and compassion of Jesus Christ, and empowered by the Holy Spirit. Amen. Stay in touch, stay healthy, stay close to God.